I'm going to show you how to do Gaussian elimination partial pivoting. We're going to talk about the theory behind Gaussian elimination partial pivoting. Now, one of the things which I would suggest to you strongly is that if you have not looked at a naive Gaussian method theory and example, that you do that before you start understanding what Gaussian elimination partial pivoting is. The reason why that is so is because there's a small difference between Gaussian elimination partial pivoting and naive Gaussian method. And in order to be able to understand what that difference is, and also because we'll be skipping steps in the Gaussian elimination partial pivoting because it's very similar to naive Gaussian method except for one step, you do need to understand that first. Now, the reason why we talk about Gaussian elimination partial pivoting is because there are certain pitfalls of the Gaussian elimination. One is that there's a possible division by zero, and the other one is that you get a large round of errors. So that's those are the two pitfalls of the naive Gaussian method when we start using that as to solve simultaneous linear equations. Now, in order to avoid the pitfalls, what we can do is we can increase the number of significant digits. And what that will do is we can go from single precision to double precision or to quad precision or extended double precision as some people might call it, or extended precision some people might call it. And what that will do is that will surely decrease the round of error. But it's not going to avoid division by zero, because no matter how many significant digits you're going to choose, if there is going to be division by zero, that is going to occur anyway. So the way to do it is we avoid that these pitfalls by using Gaussian elimination partial pivoting, where we avoid the division by zero and also reduce the round of errors. So the Gaussian elimination partial pivoting helps us in both instances of avoiding the pitfalls of the naive Gaussian method, because it avoids division by zero. Now somebody might say, hey, is this possible that we'll get division by zero even in Gaussian elimination with partial pivoting? Yes, it is possible that you will get division by zero in Gaussian elimination with partial pivoting, but that will imply that the coefficient matrix which you have is not invertible, that it is that you don't have a unique solution to the set of equations. That's what's going to happen if you're not able to avoid division by zero with Gaussian elimination with partial pivoting. So I'm going to assign that as homework, to see that whether you can come up with a set of equations where you are not able to avoid division by zero, whether you're doing Gaussian elimination with partial pivoting or naive Gaussian method. So what is different about partial pivoting? This is the only thing which is difference between Gaussian elimination partial pivoting and naive Gaussian method. This is very important for you to realize what the difference between the two is. So since at the kth step of forward elimination, what you do is you find the maximum of these values. Now, before I talk about what we mean by find the maximum of these values, you've got to understand there are n minus 1 steps in forward elimination. Because there are 100 equations, let's suppose, you'll have 999 steps of forward elimination. And you have to go through this whole process before each step of forward elimination, not just at the first step or the second step or the third step, but before the beginning of each step of forward elimination, you have to do that. So let's suppose we are at the kth step of forward elimination. So what we do is we look at the kth row, kth column, which is the diagonal element in the kth row, and then we'll look at the element which is right below the diagonal element in the same column, and all the way to the last element in the nth row. We take the absolute value of those, so that's why you find out you have these marks there. So you find the absolute value of all those elements. And once you find the absolute value of those elements, you figure out, hey, in which row do you have this maximum element? So let's suppose the maximum of all these elements which you are finding out here, the absolute value of, let's suppose the maximum element is in the pth row. So if the maximum element is in the pth row, what you're going to do is you're going to switch rows P and K. Now keep in mind that you're only switching rows P and K. You're going to make row P to be the row K and row K to be the row P. You're not moving other rows at all. The only thing which you're doing is just doing a switch, a clean switch between rows P and K. And this you do at the beginning of each step of forward elimination. And then you follow the same steps, exactly the same steps of forward elimination of the naive Gaussian method. So as an example, with symbols here, let's suppose we are at the beginning of the second step of forward elimination. So if you have the beginning step of the formulation, that means that you're going to take second row, second column as your pivot element. You're going to take the absolute value of this, you're going to take the absolute value of this. You again have another element, let's suppose A sub 4, 2, and so on and so forth, all the way up to A sub N2. You're going to take the absolute value of all of these elements, which are in the second row and below, in the second column. And then you're going to find the maximum of these. You want to find the maximum of these, and let's suppose the maximum turns out to be in fourth row. This element turns out to be the maximum of all the absolute elements which we are trying to find. If that is the case, we're going to switch row 4 with row 2. That's all we're going to do. Every other row will stay in place. So what that means is this whole row which you have right here will be switched with this second row right here, and then you will conduct the steps of forward elimination like we have done before. Nothing changes about that. So let's look at an example here. So here we are at the beginning of the second step of forward elimination. That means that I'm going to take the second row, second column here, take the absolute value of that, absolute value of this, absolute value of this. So basically what I'm doing is I'm taking the absolute value of all the second column elements below, in the second row and below. So the absolute value of this is 7, the absolute value of this is 4, the absolute value of this is 9, the absolute value of this is 17. So which one is the maximum? I know that, hey, this one is the maximum, 17 is the maximum. So if 17 is the maximum, that means that I'll have to take this row 4, so this is row 5, and this is row 2. So I'm going to do a switch. So I'll have to switch row 5 with row 2 and take this down to fifth row. So that's what I have to do in the beginning of the step of forward elimination in this example right here. Now keep in mind that when you are switching the rows, that you need to switch not only the coefficient matrix part of the row, but also the right-hand side. Same thing right here. You will have to switch this one as well as this one right here. And because the equation should not change when you go for, when you switch the rows. So this shows you how the rows have been switched. So you see that row 5, which I had previously, now has become row 2. And row 2 has become row 5. And once that switch has taken place, now you conduct the same steps of Naïve-Gaussian method of forward elimination as before. So that is not changed at all. So that's why I'm emphasizing that before you go through this presentation, that you do have looked at Naïve-Gaussian method to be able to figure out what we are trying to do here. So the Gaussian elimination partial pivoting is again a method to solve simultaneous linear equations, n equation n unknowns, and it has two steps, just like Naïve-Gaussian method of forward elimination and back substitution. The forward elimination, part is same as the Naïve-Gaussian method, except for the fact that we switch rows before each of the, at the beginning of each of the n minus 1 steps of forward elimination. And I told you that before. And as an example, this is the matrix at the beginning of the second step of forward elimination. And we're going to again look at the maximum element of the second column and below. And then depending on where the maximum is, we'll switch that row with row number 2. And this is what we get at the end of the forward elimination steps following doing that for each one of them. So what we are doing is we are making the second row, second column to be 0 below the second row. Same thing, we are making fourth row below the third column to be 0. And eventually what we are doing is we are ending up with all zeros below the diagonal, which basically makes this particular coefficient matrix into an upper triangular matrix, which you can solve by using back substitution, just like in the Naïve-Gaussian method. So in the back substitution steps are exactly the same as Naïve-Gaussian methods. The only difference between Gaussian elimination partial pivoting and Naïve-Gaussian method is in the forward elimination steps. And that too is in the beginning of each step of forward elimination. But the back substitution steps in Gaussian elimination partial pivoting and Naïve-Gaussian method, they are exactly the same. So there's no need to talk too much about it. But that's what we get. We solve the last equation for the unknown, and then we are going backwards. We are going to the second and last but one equation and keep on going backwards to find out what our unknowns are. And the reason why we see that the coefficient matrix being upper triangular matrix translates the back substitution steps into solving only one equation, one unknown at a time. And that's the end of this segment.